through it, and we're going to discuss a lot about it. His newest CD is Getting In Over My Head, which might have double meaning. On that CD, Elton John records with him, so does Paul McCartney, Brian Wilson. And with Brian is Melinda Wilson. She's been married to Brian since 1995, and she and Brian, by the way, have adopted three children, ranging in age from 5 months to 7 years. Why, Melinda?
Why not? We just, about a year into our marriage, we decided that we wanted to have children, and we didn't get married until I was 48, and so we decided that we would adopt.
You have grown children, Brian?
I've got two kids that are in their early 30s. Yeah, Carney and Wendy. They're a group called Wilson Phillips.
Oh, yeah.
That's their name, Wilson Phillips.
Did you readily go along with adopting? Did you say that?
Oh, yeah. I was in all in favor of it. I was thrilled, yeah. I was thrilled to be able to do it.
Is it fun to have kids again?
Yeah, it's great. It's wonderful.
No different feeling in adoption, is there?
No, they're just, it's just the same as if we had them. We're just as close.
It's almost more special. For some reason,
they were chosen.
Well, that's what we tell them, and it's very true.
All right, let's find out, before we go back a little, how you're doing. You've come through a lot, overcome psychological problems that
right.
Everyone knows the history of the Brian Wilson story. How are you doing?
I'm doing good. I had a little slight nervous breakdown in the 60s. I got through that, then I got through the 70s, then I was in a doctor's program during the 80s, and then I met Melinda, and we've been together ever since, and I've had a happy life.
Why, when you met Brian, was he having problems?
He was having a lot of problems when I met him. We met back in 1986, and that was during the Landy years. And
explain what that means.
There was a psychologist named Eugene Landy who
was treating
Brian. He was brought in, I guess it was late 70s by Marilyn. Originally?
Yeah. Early, mid-70s.
Marilyn, your first wife?
Yeah.
His first wife, because Brian was kind of out of control. And then, again, in the early 80s, the Beach Boys hired Dr. Landy. I don't even want to call him Dr. Landy.
Now, what did he do that so changed Brian? He was called in to help, right?
And he was called in to help, and I think originally he did help. He helped Brian lose weight, and he helped Brian care about himself physically again. But then as time went on, he became very captive of Brian, where Brian was primarily a prisoner.
I wasn't allowed to call my family or my friends at all for 9 years.
He had that much control?
Yeah, he had that much control on my life, yeah. He doped me up with medication. He kept me doped up so I couldn't resist what he told me to do.
For what purpose, Brian?
What?
Why?
He's a control freak. He gets off on controlling people.
Gene Landy, I'd like you to say hello to the reporters.
Hello.
This is Gene Landy. He covers everything from managerial to psychiatrist and singer.
People don't know how to really justify the fact that he's returned so completely. So they have to give it some sort of media concept that says Svengali type brainwashing. Well, if I've washed his brain, I've certainly done it washing out all the drugs, all the obese characteristics he had, his eating problems, his smoking problems, all the trouble that he had in his much publicized prior life, and we've washed it clean to be a healthy, whole human being. If that's brainwashing, then yeah, that's what we did.
Have you sued him?
Oh, no, I never had to sue him.
Oh, yeah, we did.
Well, I don't remember suing him, but I guess we did. If she says so.
Actually, when I married Brian, we were in the midst of 9 separate lawsuits.
How did they come out?
They all came out fine.
You
and
did okay.
For the first time in years and years and years, we're lawsuit-free.
Is Dr. Landy still practicing?
From what I understand, he's teaching in Hawaii.
Did you suffer from depression, Brian?
Did I suffer from depression? Yeah, from time to time, yeah.
Was it when you were at the top? When did it occur, while the Beach Boys were number one?
Yeah, it occurred then. Yeah, it did. And then it occurred later in the 90s, a little bit in the 90s. But 2000s, I'm not as depressed as I was. I get depressed now and then, but not very much anymore.
Actually, depression is something that if you have it, it never really goes away.
Correct.
It's been
treatable.
It's been minimized. My medicine has minimized it. Right? Been minimized?
It's absolutely been minimized.
At the height of it, though.
At the height of it, it was just god awful. I mean, it was really bad.
Contemplating ending your own life?
Well, a couple of times I had those thoughts, but I never got serious about it, though. You know, I never got serious.
What attracted you? You were stepping into. Did you ever feel, Melinda, you were stepping into a minefield here? I mean, you meet a guy with enormous talent and enormous problems.
Actually, Dr. Landy's the one that introduced us.
Really?
Yeah, which is he could probably kill himself now for, but he brought Brian into a automobile dealership that I was working at the time for Brian
to buy
a
car.
I sold Brian a car. And it was like, it was like surreal. It was like, I knew of the Beach Boys, but I really didn't know that, like, Brian was the genius behind the Beach Boys. Growing up in California.
She didn't know that much about the Beach Boys, but she learned later.
I knew I always thought Dennis was cute, his brother.
Dennis was a nice little guy. He's a really nice guy.
Let's go back and find out a little. Let's get into history, because it's been a long while since we've talked to anyone from the Beach Boys. How did it all start? It was you, Dennis, and Carl, you were the brothers.
Right.
The cousin was Mike Love, and Al Jardine was the friend, right?
Right.
Five of you.
Yeah.
How did it start?
Started out, my mom and dad took a little vacation to Mexico, and they left $250 for you know, food. But instead of food, we went and bought some instruments. We bought a bass, a guitar, and a set of drums.
You were how old at this time?
I was 19. Dennis was 15. Carl was 17. Mike was 18. Al was 19. And so we wrote a song called Surfing in my living room. We were all playing and singing. And Mike and I wrote a song called Surfing. That's how it all started.
How did that song get around? I mean, what'd you do with it?
Well, my dad took us to a record producer in Hollywood who produced Surfing with us. For us, you know, and they put it on the radio, and it was a hit. That started our career.
And when the DJ tells me that the surfing is fine, that's when I know my baby and I will have a good time.
Who named him the Beach Boys?
Who named him? A promotion man named Russ Regan.
Because you became California Music, right?
Right. Surfing USA, Surfer Girl, California Girls, you know.
Boy, at your top, you were the number one selling group in the world, right?
We were one of the number ones. We weren't number one. We were one of them. The Beatles were number one. We were number two.
But you were on a ride.
Right, yeah.
More in a minute with Brian Wilson and Melinda Wilson on this edition of Larry King Live. Don't go away. We're back with Brian Wilson and Melinda Wilson. The saga of the Beach Boys and their new CD is Getting In Over My Head. Featured on it, Elton John and Paul McCartney. We'll talk about that later on. Right now, we're tracing the histories. Did you surf? Were you a surfer?
I couldn't surf. I never learned. No, Dennis surfed. I couldn't surf. I never learned how.
He doesn't even like the ocean.
I don't like the ocean.
We did the Beach Boys special.
And the Beach Boys. He did a Richard Pryor show.
We were California Highway Patrolmen, and we went and arrested Brian right. Wilson and made him surf because he'd written all those surfing songs but never surfed. So we made him go surfing.
Come on, Brian. Let's go surfing now.
Everybody's learning how. Come on a safari with us.
Hey, Mr. Wilson, here's your wave.
Let's go.
But I haven't waxed my board yet. You should have thought of that sooner. Let's go.
How would you explain what the sound was the Beach Boys had? What What were they doing that caught the public's...
The sound was essentially the background sound, myself, Carl, Dennis, and Al Jardine. Mike was our lead singer. The four of us put our voices together, and we blended them really beautifully. We had a beautiful blend. We really did. Beautiful.
Harmonized well.
We harmonized very, very good. We were famous for our harmonies, mostly.
And how about instruments?
Instruments, we were all pretty good. I was bass, Dennis was drums, Carl was guitar, and Al was guitar. So we all played together, you know, on our shows.
How long were you a group?
From 1961 to 1998. Then we broke up after Carl died, which is too bad.
And Mike, he has the group now, is that it?
He licensed the name, yeah.
We licensed the name to Mike because he is actually the only one that really wants to go. Well, shouldn't say the only one. Al would like to, too, but we decided that Mike would be the guy to.
So he takes a group out called the Beach Boys?
He's got Bruce with him.
Bruce which, Johnston.
Yeah. And the other ones, I really don't know who the
but
other
ones are. And they have the license
they go
to use
out
the name.
Under
and
the
do you
name
get
of
a cut
choice
of what they do?
Yes.
Yeah.
So you get a percentage.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this album, Getting In Over My Head, that's just you?
Right. That's well, Desert Drive is some of the, I think, the Wondermans and some of my band were on Desert Drive, I think. But all the others, I did all the harmonies myself. It's all my voice. Yeah.
Do you write your own songs?
Yeah. I write them sometimes alone, sometimes with collaborators, yeah.
But the Beach Boys, they wrote all their own songs.
Yeah, we all wrote our own songs, yeah.
Well, all right. When your father got home from the vacation,
yeah,
and he learned that the $250 was spent on things other than he left it for, was he mad?
No, because we played him what we wrote, and he started smiling. He goes, that's great. That's a great song. You know, I thought he was going to go, get in the bathroom. You're going to get beat with a belt, you know, like he usually does.
How did you deal with early fame?
It never fazed me until later on in my career. I was too young to really understand what fame was. I couldn't understand what it was. I knew I was famous, but that didn't sink into my head.
How did you deal with having a lot of money?
I was very, very secure, financially secure my whole life. I've been, you know, I'm very lucky to say that.
So even through the Depression, everything, you took care of yourself?
Yeah, I always had money in the bank, yeah.
How do you explain that, Melinda? Normally you would think when someone goes on a downward spiral, everything goes down.
He had people, well, actually, to be honest with you, after the Landy years, it wasn't great. Because Brian wrote the songs, he continuously gets paid for the songs. And the amazing part about the Beach Boys catalog is that it doesn't take a dive. It's probably the Beatles, the Beach Boys, maybe the Rolling Stones that each year a new
keeps
generation
selling
finds the music and it increases.
Our catalogs keep moving. The Beach Boys catalog moves. We get a substantial amount of money from Rondor Music, the A&M Records owns. They bought the catalog from my dad.
Well, actually, his father sold it to him.
My father sold the catalog to A&M.
And you got played everywhere on the air, right?
Oh, yeah, we got played like crazy, yeah.
Now, you don't know them at this point. Did you know
no
the Beach Boys?
I knew the Beach Boys, but I didn't know that Brian was the genius behind the Beach Boys. I didn't realize that he wrote the songs, produced them, sang them, arranged them. In fact, it was amazing because we had George Martin visit us a couple of years ago, and he was unaware of that. That's where the Beatles had George Martin and John and Paul wrote the songs together. Brian was kind of like a one-man
You wrote
team
most of the songs?
Yeah, I did. Most of them I wrote by myself, but some of them I wrote with Mike, like Love. But and Tony Asher and Van Dyke Parks also.
When you were kids in school, before
yeah
you recorded, before you bought these instruments,
right,
were you singing in school? Were you a group?
Did no.
You, no?
No.
Why the five of you? Why those
well,
five in
because
that room?
My cousin came over to my house one day just to fool around, and he said someday we should start a rock and roll group and we could all get together. And I said, I know a guy named Al Jardine who plays bass who could probably sing good, you know. So it went from there.
And how about Mike Love? He was a friend?
He was my cousin, yeah. A cousin, he was family, and he was quite the talented singer.
And Surfing was the first thing you did.
Yeah, that was our first one. And then we did Surfer Girl. Then we did Surfing Safari in 409. Then from there, it's, you know, history.
Let's go surfing now. Everybody's learning how. Come on a safari with me.
What was it like to hear yourself on the radio?
Oh, it was a thrill. It was a big thrill. It really was. It was a big thrill for me to hear it on the radio.
Did you do a lot of concertizing?
Oh, all the time. We toured all the time.
We were always on tour.
We were always on tour, yeah.
And you were a big smash.
Yeah, yeah.
And what, there were a lot of groupies.
Oh, yeah, a lot of groupies. Yeah.
Were you married at the time?
Yes, I was, to Marilyn.
Was that tough to deal with?
Nah, I loved her.
So you didn't have a problem? You never got...
Never got...
Did the group ever get carried away with themselves?
Not really carried away. Mike became a little egotistical about things, but the rest of us were pretty humble people.
We'll be right back with Brian Wilson and Melinda Wilson, the saga of the Beach Boys. Don't go away.
We come on this loop, John B. My grandfather and me. Around Nassau town we did roam, drinking all night. Got into a fight. Well, I feel so broken. I wanna go home.
We're back with the Wilsons. Wait, did you notice early on, though, even with the success or while in school, that you had some problems?
In school, I didn't, but in the early 60s, when the Beach Boys started out, I had a little bit of a nervous breakdown.
And that entail what happened when you had a nervous?
I was on an airplane, and I said, I want to get off this airplane. I don't want to be on this airplane. And people were looking at me. I made a fool of myself, you know. I was flipping out, so I, you know. And then when we landed, my mom flew to the city where I was, where I landed, and she flew me back. I didn't go on that tour.
And they diagnosed this as a nervous breakdown.
Right.
Were you hospitalized?
No, I wasn't.
What did they do for you?
They gave me some medicine.
And what did they think caused it?
No one knows. I don't know, and they didn't know.
You had no pre-indication of any problems?
No, no one knew. No.
That's kind of how depression works. Usually with males, it starts somewhere late teens, early 20s. Because he was under a lot of pressure, that's when it seems to come out.
Do you think maybe you had too much too soon?
Probably so. I probably had a little bit too much too soon. That's probably what happened. Yeah.
All that success, young age,
right,
dealing
right.
with it, you don't think so?
No, I don't believe that at all.
What do you think?
I think it's genetic. His father suffered from depression, and from what I know about it now, it's definitely genetic. It runs in families.
How about your brothers?
My brother Carl was fine. Dennis was a very, very nervous kid, very nervous, very, very, very high-strung and nervous, and had a lot of problems, a lot of emotional problems.
The problem is they came from a very dysfunctional family. So it was hard to distinguish in the beginning whether it was the dysfunctional family causing Brian's problems, or eventually what we found out, it was depression.
But you couple
the two, and it's not a good...
But look at all the talent emanating from that.
But look at all the talented people that do suffer from depression. I mean, they're beginning to believe that it has something to do with the creative part of your brain.
Yeah, because we're just beginning to study it. We know
right.
depressed people often are very successful.
That's
people.
Correct.
Right.
That's
all right.
Correct.
When after this plane episode, and you come back...
Yeah.
And when you went out singing again, was that hard?
No, actually, I was over my I was over the nervous breakdown, and I went out and I had a good time performing. And I haven't had a nervous breakdown since.
At some point, you decided that you didn't want to go out anymore.
With the Beach Boys?
Mm-hmm.
In 1965, that was, yeah.
What happened?
I took LSD and some different kinds of amphetamine pills, and it... messed my head up to where I couldn't concentrate very much on music, so I had to bow out of the Beach Boys. Plus, I also wanted to stay home and write songs for them. While they were on the road, I would be home writing, and when they came back, they would just record with it.
So they went out as a foursome?
Right, right. No, they hired Glenn Campbell to go out with him.
Was it called Glenn Campbell and the Beach Boys, or just the
Beach
Boys?
No, just the Beach Boys. Glenn Campbell was, and then when Glenn left, Bruce Johnson came in and took my place. So we were covered.
He's with them now, right?
Huh?
He's with them now?
Yeah, yeah.
Glenn, where'd you find Glenn?
Mike found him. I didn't find him. Mike found him.
That was a pretty lucky find.
Yeah. He's a great singer, Glenn.
And a pretty good guitar player.
Yeah, he's very good at guitar, yeah.
So he blended right in.
Oh, yeah, he was blended in beautifully.
Why didn't you want to sing anymore?
It wasn't that I didn't want to sing. I didn't want to go on tour. It had nothing to do with singing. I just wanted to, write some songs.
When they recorded, did Glenn record with them or you?
I did.
So you still remained in the recording studio?
Right.
You,
I was part of the recording group, but not part of the touring group. Right.
You didn't miss that?
No. Then in 1969 or 1970, I started going back out with him. Throughout the 70s, sporadically, I would go out with him in the 70s.
And did you have problems? Was it difficult to be on stage?
Oh, no. I got off on it. I loved it. I loved every moment of it, every minute. It was...
Were you by nature, Brian, an experimenter? When you say you took LSD in life, were you attracted to that kind of thing?
Not really, no. No, actually not, no. I've had medicine, a lot of medicine in my life, but I've taken a few drugs since the 60s.
But in the 60s you did, a lot of people were.
That's when the big thing was taking dope, smoking dope, yeah. I did my share of that.
But the funny part about it is Brian's doctor now says that in terms of what most people were doing in the 60s, Brian didn't do much. I mean, when he talks about LSD, he took 3 trips. Now, in the 60s, that wasn't a lot. But what people have a tendency to do that suffer with depression is they use drugs and alcohol to medicate themselves.
It's called nepenthe, alcohol and morphine. The word is, nepenthe means numbing the soul, numbing your soul.
Because all of a sudden, I mean, you're normal, and then all of a sudden you start hearing voices in your head, and things start happening to you that you don't know whether to tell people or, And I think with Brian, you went a long time without discussing it with...
Why not?
I was afraid to.
Yeah, I would imagine. I can understand. When you say you heard voices, can you describe what that's like? Because we read stories like that about people who... What happens?
Well, the voices say, I'm going to hurt you. I'm going to kill you. I said, please don't kill me.
It's an actual voice.
Yeah, actual voice in my head. Yeah.
Not your voice.
No.
They're called auditory hallucinations. And if somebody's depression is deep enough, that's what happens to them. And
at the same time, you're still writing songs.
Yeah, I could still write songs. Yeah, during that period.
Write hit songs.
Yeah.
That's the thing that's so amazing. I mean, like, right now, when he goes out on tour, I can look at him and I can... I say to myself, oh, my God, I can tell just by his face. He's hearing voices.
You still hear them, then?
Oh, yeah, I still hear them.
And yet, he continues to do the concert. It's amazing.
Is that a form of schizophrenia?
There's a very... It's a schizoaffective disorder, is what they call it, actually. And there's a very fine line between depression, schizophrenia, bipolar. Yeah. It's a degree.
You're very brave to come and talk about it. We'll be right back with more Brian Wilson and Melinda Wilson. Getting In Over My Head is currently out. That CD, we're going to talk about that, too. Don't go away.
Wouldn't it be nice?
discussing the life and times of the brilliant Brian Wilson. With us is his wife, Melinda. They have three adopted children. Brian currently tours as just Brian Wilson. When you tour as just... Yeah. You can't do the Beach Boys, right?
No, I just go under my own name. Right.
Were you hit as a kid?
Was I hit?
Yeah, did your father, was he rough with you? Did you have a physical...
Yeah, quite rough with me, yeah. I was whipped a lot, yeah.
Are you hard of hearing?
I'm deaf in my right ear.
It's due to beatings?
No, I was born deaf.
Born deaf?
Yeah, my right ear.
Boy, things were not easy, were they?
No, not easy at home, not when I was growing up, no. But then after I got out of my house, I felt better.
All right, back to the hearing things.
Yeah.
You could hear them now?
I still hear things like, I'm going to kill you, but I don't hear very many other kind of thoughts. Just usually negative thoughts or negative whatever, you know.
You ever hear them while you're singing?
No, not when I'm singing, no.
When you're writing?
No, not then either.
When then would you hear them like?
When I'm not singing or writing.
You might hear him driving in a car.
He comes in periods. There'll be three or four hours will go by, and then all of a sudden they'll come back in.
And how do you deal with it?
I deal with it in a manner of understanding what it is. And when he's going through these bouts of depression, which, by the way, used to last maybe somewhere from a month to a couple of weeks. Since he's got a new doctor and since he's been taking these new medications,
he's better.
Much better. I mean, he never spends a day in bed.
How do the kids deal with it?
The kids don't really even see it, I don't think.
They weren't really told, actually. They were never told that I had auditory hallucinations.
And they're young enough to where, you know, sometimes they'll say, "What's wrong? Is Daddy feeling not good today?"
But do you grown children? How do they react to all this?
Well, they love me. They don't really think, they don't really relate to me as a crazy person that has voices, you know.
Does it ever issue commands, these voices?
What the what?
Ever tell you to do things?
No.
Just, I'm going to kill you, or?
Yeah, right.
That's all it ever says?
Yeah.
Is that some sort of self-wish?
No, I don't think so. But they tell him other things as well, like...
Like?
They'll say, like...
You're no good, or...
Something like that, yeah.
You know, and then there are days that they might be good to him.
That happens. Every few days they'll
have... Good to you by praising you, you mean?
Right. They'll say, we love you, we can't do without you, and stuff like that. You know?
Basically what it is, it's an imbalance of the chemicals in his brain. So
had nothing to do with low self-esteem or anything?
It could. I mean, it could. There's no one particular reason. There's just the conglomerations of reasons for Brian. I mean,
because the great puzzle would be is, How on earth could Brian Wilson have low self-esteem?
I have self-esteem. Yeah, I have.
Yeah, but the perfect example, Bri, was like the first time we went on tour, like about 4 or 5 years ago, where he really had no indication of knowing how much people loved him because he hadn't been on tour for years. And I think you were really quite surprised by the reaction that you got from people, weren't
I did.
You?
I was very, very surprised. I never thought I would be that loved or, you know, respected. But she's still dancing in the night and afraid of what a doodle do. In a town
full of heroes and villains. When you walked out on stage,
yes.
What was that like?
Scary. It was scary at first, but after we played our first note, I was okay. I was all right. A little scary for me.
And then the crowd, of their appreciation of you.
Oh, that thrilled me to death. I was thrilled to death, yeah.
And he was so surprised by it. It was like...
Didn't you know how well-regarded you were by the public?
I didn't know.
I mean,
know.
You were an institution.
How was I to know? I didn't know until I tried my first tour, and then I found out.
People were just happy to see that he could
what,
show up.
Melinda, was the most difficult part for you in the beginnings of this relationship?
Brian having a tendency to push me away at times when he felt that things were becoming too close and too intimate. And I think he does that because he's afraid to be disappointed. He's afraid that he's going to get disappointed. So consequently, he just says, I'm going to walk away from this.
Still does it?
Not to me, but he does it. I see him do it to other people.
Do you think that's true?
I think minimally. I don't think I do it to too many people. Now and then I'll be a little brief with some of my band members. You know, I won't talk, you know, or I'll refrain from talking to my band while we're rehearsing. But basically, I'm friendly with people, you know.
But how about, like, with your collaborators?
I'll go on cold streaks. Like, I'll work with a collaborator, then I'll stop calling the collaborator for a couple of weeks. I'll say, I need a break from you for a couple of weeks. And I'll say, okay, fine, I'll talk to you in 2 weeks.
And that was the hardest thing for me to understand. When he's so honest. He'd just call me up and say, this was before we were married. You know, I really like you and everything, but I need a break. And I'm going, you really like me?
And I'll try my best not
to. But I need a break.
I'll try not to hurt feelings or people's feelings when I say that.
But
he's honest.
Honest. And now I totally understand why.
We'll be right back with Brian and Melinda Wilson. Don't go away.
In this world I love you.
We're back with Brian Wilson and Melinda Wilson. Tell me about Getting In Over My Head, how they came together.
Well, we all decided we should do another album, another solo album, because the last one was in 1998 called Imagination. So I started writing songs, and then we picked songs from the past and songs of recent years, and then I wrote some original songs. So all in all, it's over a period of like 15, 20 years.
Who titled it?
Who titled it? The record company did, yeah.
Is there a song called Getting In Over My Head?
Yeah, there is, yeah.
Is there a personal saga in that?
No, not a personal saga.
You don't
story.
Think you're in over your head?
No, well, I actually did not write that lyric. You know, it was written by Andy Paley, and I don't know exactly. I think he means he's getting into a love affair too deep, you know.
How did Elton John get involved?
I met him, I think, either in New York or London, I'm not sure, about 2 years ago. And I said to him, would you ever consider working with me on an album of mine? And he goes, I'd love to. So come about 4 months ago, I called him up and asked him if he would let me send him a tape or a CD of the song called How Can We Still Be Dancing? And I sent it to him, and he learned how to sing the song. And he came to L.A., and he did it in 20 minutes. It took him 20 minutes to get the thing done, and he left. And he left the studio. 20 minutes.
What was it like working with him?
Oh, it was a thrill. It was a big thrill for me.
Now, how about the meeting with Paul McCartney?
I talked to Paul McCartney over the years, ranging from 1967 to 2004.
Talked to him in person,
yeah.
You met him and...
At the Landmine show, he did God Only Knows with me, and I did Let It Be with him. And then I called him about 4 months ago and asked him if he'd come out and sing on a song called A Friend Like You, which I wrote for him, me and my collaborator wrote it for him. And he said he'd love to come out, and he came out, and he came to the studio, and... That was one of the bigger thrills of my life, to tell you that to produce Paul McCartney, and that was a thrill for me. That was a thrill.
You wrote the song?
Yeah, me and...
A Friend Like You.
And the lyrics were written by Steve Kalinich.
And it was referring to Paul?
To Paul, yeah.
And he sang it?
Yes, he did. He sang some of it, yeah.
What a thrill that must have been like.
Oh, it was such a thrill.
I think the first time we ran into him was at the Queen's Jubilee, when they invited Brian back to do the 50th Jubilee for the Queen.
Oh, you were at that?
I was there. I sang and performed at that show. I met the Queen, too.
Brian and Tony Bennett were like the two only Americans.
That's great.
Russ and Eric Clapton, Elton John, and Paul McCartney, yeah. I guess.
Wow.
And so that's kind of how he got, you know, reunited with these guys.
And who's distributing Getting In Over My Head?
Rhino. Rhino Records.
Rhino Records.
Warner Brothers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's great. And it's everywhere now.
Oh,
right?
It's selling like crazy, yeah.
This doctor, back to this doctor, how did that connection occur, and how did it last so long? You were here for all that, right?
I was here for the ending of it.
Did you end it?
I had a lot to do with ending it. Mm-hmm. It was, I
a
could...
control thing.
It was a control thing. Sometimes I equate it as almost a child being abused by somebody, and I didn't know what to do about it, because every time we were out, there was never a family member or a friend. It was always Landy and his goons, as I call them. And one time, Brian called his mother from my cell phone, and I finally got a phone number. And so I tried to get a hold of her, and she was very suspicious about the call, so it was like so scary. I didn't know what to do. It was like it was like really scary. So then I met a friend of Brian's, David Leaf, who was the biographer that had written a book about Brian, and he filled me in on all the background of what was happening. And I went to the attorney general and told him that something really wrong was happening here.
And did they investigate?
They did investigate, but they told me that they needed a family member to be involved. And so after 3 years of having meetings with his brother and his brother's attorney, his brother decided to do something about it.
You weren't a family member.
I wasn't a family member. Couldn't do anything about it. It's amazing how these things happen.
How you got sucked in, Brian?
To the 90 program?
Yeah.
I was referred to him by my wife in 1975, December the 20th of 1975.
Remember the date?
Yeah. He said, I'm going to put you on a program to try to get you back into mental shape, so you're not going to go looking for heroin and drugs like that. I bought some heroin, and my wife found the heroin. Can you believe that?
So his intentions at that time were noble, right? I mean, he wanted to get you off drugs.
During that period of time, he was okay, yeah.
And then what happened?
Here's the deal. Here's the deal that always, like, strikes me. They live 10 minutes from UCLA. The best doctors in the world are at UCLA. And finally, that's who we took Brian to UCLA with a team of three doctors who helped get him in the shape that he's in today. It was just like, why would you find the kookiest kook out there? Why wouldn't you, like, you know, this is Brian Wilson. Why wouldn't you take him?
My wife didn't know he was a crazy man.
Was it hard to let go?
A little bit hard for me to let go, yeah. It was hard.
When you've had a control figure in your life for that long a period.
9 years. Starting from 1983 to 1992. It was 9 years of control, and...
Were you singing, recording, and writing during that?
Yeah, I was writing, singing, recording. I did a solo album in 1988.
Which Dr. Landy had a huge involvement in.
He was involved in the songwriting.
He had his name all over the songs, and...
He did write. He and his wife did write, you know, some songs with me. They collaborated.
We'll, in our remaining moments, find out what Brian Wilson does now, how optimistic he is, what the story of this whole family is, and where they go from here. The CD is Getting In Over My Head. We'll be right back.
Yeah, but I couldn't wait to get back in the States, back to the cutest girls in the world. I wish they...
Back with the Wilsons. One other thing, there was once an attempted album, right? 1967 Smile.
We got some of it done then, but we junked it. We threw it away because I thought it was too advanced for people to hear. I thought it was a little bit too advanced.
Advanced.
It had a very avant-garde feeling about it. It was a little bit too advanced.
Whatever happened to it?
We didn't do anything to it until 2004.
And when's it coming out?
We think September or October we're shooting for.
And how better is he now than when you met him?
Oh, my God. It's day and night difference. When I first met him, he would have bouts of depression that would put him in bed. But not only that, he would stay in bed for months at a time. And it never happens anymore. But I think a lot of it has to do for people that are suffering from depression. They need to, number one, find a great psychiatrist. Number two, get the proper medication that they need. And it's not an easy task to do that. You go through a lot of medications before you find the combination that works. But the most important thing, I think, is a person's environment. They have to be in a loving environment.
If there's not love present, it's much, much harder to function. When there's love present, it's easier to deal with life.
Still hard, though.
Yeah, still hard, but easier when I have the love of my family, I feel a little bit better.
Can you write while depressed?
Yeah, absolutely. I can be depressed as hell and write, yeah.
You ever listen to old Beach Boys records?
No, we don't wallow in the mire over the Beach Boys. I used to listen to Andy Williams and Kenny Rogers and stuff like that, Perry Como.
Nat King Cole,
of course, that was our song. Mm-hmm. When I Fall in Love was our song. When I Fall in Love. It will be forever. You know that song?
Or I'll never fall in love in a restless world like this is.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know that.
Yeah, it's a beautiful tune.
You're a beautiful guy.
Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Thank you, Larry.
Brian Wilson and Melinda Wilson, the new CD is Getting In Over My Head, and this fall, Smile will finally be released. Thanks for joining us. I'll be back in a couple of minutes. Don't go away. Thanks for joining us on this edition of Larry King Live with Melinda Wilson and the great Brian Wilson. Stay tuned now for more news around the clock on your most trusted name in news, CNN. See you tomorrow night. Good night.